Following is intended for mature audiences. Viewer discretion is advised.
We want thickness.
Like I just stepped in a flight club looking at what's behind you, dog.
Yeah, my own Foot Locker. My own Foot Locker, baby.
I love my it.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to have to switch seats when I'm ruining y'all's podcast today.
No worries. It's just like, it's like Pimp My Ride, but O’Mya edition.
Definitely not Pimp My Ride. It's more, yeah.
Hey, we heard you like titties, so we put some titties in your car.
Yes, titties, yes. Titties. Definitely put titties in the car.
All right. Oh, my God, with the sneaker rotating?
Yeah. Got to have it. Got to have that, baby. Got to have it.
Okay.
That's my number one hobby. This porn is all a hustle, baby. That's my number one hobby, sneakers.
Sneaker collecting, okay. Yeah. So I take it that's been going on for a long time with you?
Since I was in the fourth grade, I got my first pair of Jordans back in 84, 85 time frame.
Okay, and how many do you currently own right now? And is it exclusively Nikes or exclusively Jordan?
It's everything, bro. I mean, some people, you know, consider themselves sneakerheads because they got the Yeezys and the Jordans. Bro, I got everything from old school Kangaroos, the Converse. I got all of them. So I rock anything I rock some exclusive stuff that people can't get, you know? And then just like the big red boots, you know, everybody's on the big red boots now.
I ain't rocking them. Those look so fucking ridiculous, dog. Exactly. I mean, they're straight up out of cartoon, man. They're doing that Astro Boy and that Pac-Man meme for a reason.
Exactly.
But guess what? Mars has them.
I hit on the draw the night before last.
Yeah,
and it costs $369 from Mischief, but the flip now is going for $1,500 to $1,600, and that's what I'm about to do, flip.
I mean, so, if you're going to an anime convention, hey, props to you, you know, fit in and wear those shits, but other than that, I'm like, Gen Z done lost their minds, you know, just trying to be silly, you know what I mean?
Exactly.
We want thickness.
What is up, everybody? You are tuned into the Thiccness Protection Program. This is the podcast celebrating body positivity and where adult stars open up about whatever the fuck. We are bringing body positivity to the adult content creator community. And if you don't already know, I am the Thiccness Pro. Well, I got a cool partner of mine ready to get down with the thickness in the house. And I also got a lovely returner coming through to be my co-host today. O’Mya BBW is right beside me, even though she's in her car. And you're on the road, O’Mya, aren't you? Where are you at right now?
No, I'm actually back in Kentucky. I just got back from Denver. So
okay, back from Denver. All right, how was the trip out there?
It was good. It was a quick trip, just a photo shoot, and I went to the Meow Wolf art exhibit out there. So
dope. We're gonna get into that too, but I want my guest to introduce himself. Go on ahead, brother.
What's going on? It's your boy Mars Blac XXX, straight out of Charleston, South Carolina, by way of North Carolina. Amateur independent male talent. Been in and out of this thing since 2005. Couldn't really get into it full swing due to my military obligations. And I'm a Virgo. So there you go. September 17th, if you want to send me a gift.
Very dope. Okay. So Mars, we're going to dive into your whole entire backstory and all, but first of all, let's just answer the fact and cross this box off. How did you get into the adult business?
Pardon the interruption, protectors, but this is Pimp and Palm, the Mac and Memoji. And before we go any further in this interview, I'm going to need you to click that like button, subscribe to the channel, and turn on your notification bell. And if you're listening on Spotify, make sure you are following the podcast. And please leave a rating before you get up on out of here. Now back to the Thiccness Protection Program. Pimp and Palm, the Mac and Memoji. You dig?
We want thickness.
Ex-wife. Pretty ex-wife, and I would say, well, let me backtrack. So it's 2005. There's a site, and it's still in full swing. I don't know if you heard of it. Southerncharms.com.
Yes, I'm not super familiar, but it has been brought up on the podcast before.
So me personally, I've been a porn connoisseur for years, man, since early age. And anyway, this site has been around since the 90s, and I came across it. Basically, it's a website full of amateur women, you know, wives, teachers, you name it, everybody amateur. So I was a connoisseur of observing and watching these women on this site. And then lo and behold, back in the day, in the late 90s, they had a Southern Gents sub part of it. And I would say it's probably about 100 of us guys on at the time. And so me being me, I'm like, well, shit, let me get on here and, you know, it's a chance to get on here and be like a, you know, male model and see if anybody wants to do anything. This was way before OnlyFans and stuff. And they used to have meet and greets at a place in Charlotte, North Carolina. They used to do some content trade. So got on there in 05 and was doing my thing solo. And then I got deployed to Iraq in 06. So I had to come down off the site. And then I decided to come back on back in 2010 when I met my ex-wife. She was a model on Southern Charms. And of course, when you got a hot chick that's in the game or whatever, and people are trying to, you know, collaborate with her and do things for her, you know, we connected. And she at the time was going down to Florida to get her photos done by a photographer. Funny thing about this, let me backtrack a little bit on this. Funny thing about this, her mother was also doing porn.
No kidding.
Exactly. So I originally had seen her mama on the site, didn't know it was her mother, didn't know who it was.
Classic.
Yeah, classic. And when we I hit her up when I first saw her, she was a pog, 5 foot nothing, Italian chick. And I hit her up to collab, and she gave me like the cold shoulder at first. And you know, then she swung back around, spun the block, came back, was like, hey, do you wanna shoot? And we shot in Cocoa Beach back in like January of 2011. And I went down, met her. Her mother answered the door, actually. Her mother, they was doing a shoot during that time. The mother came, and I'm like, damn, I know you, but I don't know you and shit. And so that's how it was. So we got together, hit it off, and, you know, everybody, again, I was doing her photography and videography, her answering the emails and things like that, and we working together and doing stuff together and collaborating together. And so that's how we sort of got out there as a couple. And, you know, I networked and met some people. Met Virgo Paradise at the time. Virgo was on the site. And, you know, just got out there back then. So I would say, yeah, that's how it all came to pass.
Incredible. It was through a mother and a daughter.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. So even that predates, you know, the Kendra Cox and Venus Flytrap era. That's fire. And shout out to those ladies as well.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's start with Mars on day one. So you grew up in the Carolinas. Right. Tell me about what was Mars like as a kid.
Single child, grew up with my mom, my dad, spoiled same riding.
Here. Same the fuck here, man.
Yeah, you see behind child. Me, I like what I like. O'Mya, yeah. I can tell you, I've been knowing O'Mya now going on about a year, and she's already know, I'm a polo head, polo connoisseur. If it ain't Ralph, I don't want it. Sneakers, watch, cologne, I'm just that grown man vibe type shit, you know? So that's just me. I'm a laid back, funny guy. You know, besides the porn and everything, I would say, you know, I'm a comedic person, like to make memes, keep everybody laughing throughout the day. You'll never see me without a smile on my face, man. And that's how I live life.
Very dope. Okay. Now you were in the military?
Yeah, man. I came out of high school at 17, joined the Marine Corps, went down to Paris Island, South Carolina. And I spent 8 years in the Corps. I got out. I was a single father raising my daughter. And then I spent about a year and 2 months out and moved back home, my mom, my dad in North Carolina. For about a year and 2 months, I stayed out. And during that year and 2 months, I had about 10 different jobs during that year and 2 months. So, and I'm like, I'm about 25, 26 at the time. And I'm like, I'm trying to raise my daughter, but either I was getting jobs that paid money, but they had no benefits, or either they had benefits, but didn't pay no money. So I'm like, man, the military won't bad, but I don't want to go back to the Marine Corps because we ran too damn much. You know, I'm like, I ain't knew I was running no more. So originally I looked at the Air Force, but they were trying to knock me down a couple of ranks and I wasn't trying to lose what I worked for after 8 years. And then the Navy were hiring, recruiting for basically what they call military, master in arms, which is their military police. Right. Because it was after September 11th, they was really recruiting for people. So I was able to come into the Navy and I lost the rank, but I was able to pick it back up about 8 months later. And I did the Navy for 13 years, so a total of 21 years altogether. And I retired back in 2014 and worked for the feds because my background was law enforcement. So I worked for an agency with the feds for about 3 years. And then I hung all that stuff up back in 2017 and hadn't looked back since and just been doing me and enjoying life, traveling and doing what I want to do with nobody to answer to.
Very dope. Okay. So yeah. When you got out of, you know, the law enforcement and the working world, how was that transition to, you know, you being an entrepreneur, a content creator and kind of doing your thing? Because your story kind of predates the internet boom of the porn industry. Correct me if I'm wrong. What up, Palm Tree? It's your boy Chillin' Dylan, Jesus of SoundCloud, Black Tom Anderson, and your favorite rapper still owes me money. Now, my partner Sal G is back with another single, and this one is called Ennui. Smoking all day, sipping all night. You already know how he's getting down, man. Is it an addiction anthem, though, is the question. Well, this is going to be one of those ones that's got this jazz-type style beat, and you're going to want to just kick back and vibe to it.
Yeah. Stress-free, stress and drama-free, man. Like I said, I I tell everybody, you know, in the military, you know, certain things you can and cannot do, certain things you can and cannot say. It's like you got a gag order on you, you know, especially when it comes to politics or whatever else that may be. And now, you know, not having to punch a clock or not having to worry about, you know, the policies of a company and things of that nature. You know, I can say what I want to say and do what I want to do and go as I please and whatnot. So it's been stress and drama free. Back when I hung all that stuff up in 2017, I'm married now. My current wife, she had actually was online and saw Lyft and was like, hey, you know, you want to do something, get out, make some money. And I actually that's one of my primary hustles. I've been doing Lyft for the past 5.5 years as my primary hustle for my sneaker collection. That's it. So that's easy, stress-free, drama-free life, bro.
Very dope. Okay, so you haven't had a boss in quite a while. You are the boss. Yeah,
exactly. That's why you see the face tattoos and everything. You know, when people say face tattoos, that mean you ain't trying to work for nobody else no more because you're already going to be stereotyped. And, you know, and I get that even when I'm driving, picking up people. You know, I might pick somebody up from the airport and, you know, they sort of skeptical when I got tats all on me and like, who is this guy I'm getting into the car with? And then, you know, if they talk and I tell them my story and, you know, you can tell their attitude changes a little bit. Oh, thank you for your service to our country and this and that and whatnot. But yeah, I don't plan on working for nobody else as long as I'm on this earth. So that's it, man.
Very dope. Well, yep. I'll tell you the reason I brought this lovely young lady O’Mya along with us today is because she shot her first hardcore scene with you. You guys shot together?
Correct.
Yep.
Is that right?
First collab.
All right. O’Mya, can you speak on that experience?
Honestly, the drama-free part was why I shot with Mars first. We talked for, hell, probably 3 or 4 months beforehand.
Correct.
And it was easy. We picked a date, picked a place. He brought some of his equipment. I brought mine. We had Quentin come. It was just super easy. And we shot, 3 or 4 scenes that weekend?
Exactly. Yep.
3 or 4 scenes that weekend.
Right. And what city was that in? Atlanta, if I'm not mistaken?
Yeah, Atlanta. Yep.
Okay. So is there a different kind of vibe or a different culture when you guys travel from place to place? O’Mya, you're on the road frequently. Like when you touch down in a city, is it like, okay, I'm shooting in Vegas and there might be, you know, conventions like a ABN or an Exotica going on, or when you touch down in Nashville or you touch down in Atlanta or NYC, like what's the vibe like place to place?
Conventions are always different. Like that's like the worst. I would rather schedule with somebody like what me and Mars did and just like spend a whole weekend just shooting with them compared to trying to do 12 shoots in a weekend with random people during a convention, because people cancel, people get sick. Like convention shooting isn't for the week.
Yeah, it kind of sounds to me like a fishbowl of people coming in, coming out. You don't know who the fuck you're going to end up dealing with, and it's just all these different personalities. Versus, I get the vibe if it's like, okay, if I'm coming to Lexington, okay, I know you're there, people you'd want to work with, and then it's you're just doing that with your peoples in that town. Is that how it is?
I mean, yes, for the most part. Like whenever I go to Nashville, there's like 2 or 3 people I'll work with down there, and then that's it. But we do a lot of work during that weekend. Same thing for Atlanta. Like there's maybe 4 or 5 people down there that I work with, and it's easy. Everybody shows up and does their part. I haven't really got lucky with working with anybody in Kentucky that's like dependable and all that good stuff. So still on the road traveling.
Got you. Okay. I'll open this to both of you guys, whoever wants to yield it first. But like, does the location really matter, like the city matter, or is it more about the people that you're working with? Are there certain cities you prefer to shoot some content in more than others?
Ladies first, go ahead, Amaya.
For me, it's the people. Like, you got to have dependable people, and that's hard. That's hard to get to, but at this point, I have like 7 people I know are going to show up, do their part, and we're going to make some fire scenes. It doesn't, like, the city don't matter. As long as those people are in that city, the city really don't matter to me.
Dig it.
I'd agree. For me, I burn the road up 24/7. I don't mind a road trip. You know, if you special anywhere up and down the East Coast, I'm about it. I get behind the wheel and burn it up. Not necessarily out to the West. I do got a spot that I own, a timeshare in Vegas, that I go out probably about three times a year. So when I'm out there, I definitely try to take advantage and let people know that I'm going to be in Vegas. And if they want to come over from Cali or whatever, they can meet me. But I'm cool with traveling all up and down pretty much the East Coast.
I do have a question for you, Mars.
Yeah.
I know you travel to the ladies wherever we're at. You'll come to us to shoot scenes. Where can female content creators that might not want to collab yet meet you this year? Like, convention-wise, where can they meet you?
Oh, I'll be back. You know, I've already got it posted on my Twitter. I'll be back up. I'll be at, well, in Chicago. This first time for Exotica, I'll be up there April the 20th through the 24th. And then, I'll be back at the, I think it's the 15-year anniversary in New Jersey. I really enjoyed New Jersey's Exotica last year, so I'll definitely be back at New Jersey in November of this year for that convention. So those two conventions are for sure.
Okay, I know some people they don't want to meet you for the first time to do a collab, so that'd be a great place for them to meet you.
Exactly. Thank you for throwing that out there.
Well, let me ask you guys this. What do you prefer, the collabs or working with the studio?
Me, the collabs. I like to do my own thing. And I'm going to tell you why, because I've tried when I, so I really got back my feet hot and heavy in this thing back in 2020, you know, right? Pandemic. Or whatever. And the freedom of being independent and calling your own thing, doing your own thing. And, you know, because I said, I'm in front of the camera, behind the camera, editing the footage, putting it all together. Just me having the flexibility to do it how I want to do it compared to, you know, in front of the lights. And that person just don't work for me. All the blaring lights and people in there. So I like to do my thing one-on-one in the collabs and have that freedom to do it myself. I have... worked with a few companies, and I shot with, and I can die happy with this, saying this, brother. I shot with Sara J at Exotica last October. So, I mean, I can die happy. That's the day I'm GOAT.
That was literally the next question on my list, man. How the fuck was it to, you know, get in there and work with a legend?
Listen, I thought I was getting catfished when they reached out to him. I swear to God, man. So I'm on Twitter. You know, and her people reached out. It was one of her guys and hits me up and was like, you know, hey, you're going to be at Exotica? And I'm like, yeah. And it's like, you know, would you like to shoot with Sara J? And we're trying to get some fresh faces and stuff like that. I'm sitting here like, yeah, whatever, man. Hey, this is some catfish shit. So gave my information or whatever. And then about a day or two later came back and it was like, okay, we got you on the books with Sara J and Kaylani Kai. And woo! I'm like, wait a minute. Hold on, man. I mean, I'm good with Sara. That's I'm good. You know, like, where's this other chick coming from? And he's like, yeah, we want to do this scene. And I'm like, okay. So your boy was nervous. I ain't gonna lie, I ain't gonna fret. I was nervous as hell. But she made me feel welcome. It was her, Kaylani, and now videographer, and it was smooth. I mean, it was smooth selling, you know, just no pressure and good times, man.
Very dope, man. I gotta ask, man, working with Kaylani Kai, how was it?
She awesome chick. I'm hoping she'll be back in April in Chicago, and maybe we can do a one-on-one scene. Okay.
And you did a threesome with Sara J and Kaylani Kai?
Yes.
And you said you were nervous, but like when you really were in there, like did you feel like you had to go Super Saiyan at one point, or was it like a mind over matter thing? How did you control yourself?
Just mind over matter, man. Just like, you know, because I was preparing for this. I had made some notes and stuff about this. I remember seeing Sara when she initially came out back in the late 90s. I remember I was in the Marine Corps, stationed down in Beaufort, South Carolina, and remember her come to the forefront when I think it was a chick named Raven Black that brought her out. And I'm like, you know, just me and my roommate was like, who is this chick? This was the days of web TV. I don't know if you remember web TV, the whole dial-up keyboard and a little box. You used to connect it to your TV and look at the internet. And I'm just like, my boy would come in like, you on the internet again? I'm like, yeah, man. I'm looking at these paws on here, man. Just
definitely before my time, man. I'm like the TiVo and the Netscape Composer era. I'm Firefox. I'm Internet Explorer, you know, that time.
Google web TV, man.
Web TV.
Keyboard in a box to get your ass online.
I think, bro. I remember seeing ads for that, bro, because people used to call my dad Inspector Gadget. Like, he just had, like, all the shit that came out. But, like,
yeah,
we had, you know, TiVo, and then I had Xbox Live on the 360. But, yeah, web TV, not it. That's crazy. So that was the first internet browser for the television?
I think pretty much that was by Philips web TV. And I knew I had to get it. So I get online and get on the internet and look at these chicks. But, you know, just trying to overcome, like, the amazement of seeing her and the star that she is and remember where she came from to be able to work with her 20 years later. So, yeah, I had to, you know, I came in. I was like, I'm nervous. And they was like, no, don't be nervous. Just be cool. We just the average people. And they were. So it was good times.
I want both you guys to share with me, like, what is your pre-scene ritual? You know, what are you not eating certain things? Are you meditating? Or, you know, what are some of the things you do to prep yourself for a scene?
Go to my.
Well, I mean, obviously I completely exfoliate my body, get it right. Got to have that hygiene together. And my playlist is like some Lover Girl stuff while I'm getting ready for a scene. I like to have passionate scenes. And then there's really nothing like I don't eat or nothing. Like, that's not really. I drink a lot of water. Yeah, things get wet sometimes.
We like it wet. We like it wet.
We do like it wet. We like it to get wet.
Exactly. Me, I'm sort of the same way. I'm drinking water, plenty of water. And it's funny because, again, I go back to my comedic stages. I get into the mindset of Boogie Nights at the end of the movie with old boy talking to his shit. And like, let's go to work. Let's get right. And I'm, you know, meditating like, hey, let's go to work. And that's what I just think about Boogie Nights, man, is trying to get through that scene and making it do what it do.
There you go. Okay. Well, Mars, I wanted to know, you know, you've been married twice.
I've been married four times.
Whoa, excuse me, four times. Yeah. So I love this when I edit and post to do the sonic ring sound effects when people say how many times they've been losing the rings. Yep. But okay. So you've been married four times. How does your adult career affect your personal love life? And, you know, do you have any advice, knowing that you've been in these relationships and grown from them and, you know, been down this road many times?
So with that being said, it's my fourth and final marriage. I can say that. I know it is. The three previous ones, great women. I'm not gonna get on here in front, great women, but I'm man enough to admit that they failed due to my infidelities. You know, I love women, and your boy was out here cheating and running them streets ragged, straight up. And so my current wife is my biggest supporter, number one fan. I mean, I can't ask for a better support system with her. She knows what she knew from day one what I did and what I like, what I enjoy. To the point, even before I put the ring on and tied the knot, my mom, because I'm my mama's son, my mom was like, look, my son ain't changing who he is and what he likes to do. And she was like, yeah, I know. And I accept him for what he is and who he is. And so when I met my fourth wife, she was the biggest freak out of my 40 years that I had ever met and still is to this day. So the sex is good at home, but my ability to be able to, what I call it, going out sometime and sticking my hand in the cookie jar, because that's all it's sticking, you know, doing what I do is, again, stress and drama free. It's all about communication. And, you know, and wifey knows, she doesn't necessarily, she don't be, you know, she sees some clips and stuff that I post on Twitter, IG and stuff, but she's not necessarily looking at my footage. Hell, I don't even look at my stuff every time after I shoot it or whatever. I don't go back personally and look at my own stuff. Yeah.
So once a video is out, it's out. You're not, you know, going back for viewing pleasure or going back to say, oh, how did I stroke here? Should I do this differently? You're not revisiting any of your own content.
Nope. So I got a friend of mine, Becky Taylor. They are amateur. They real big on Pornhub. They are out of Virginia. And me and her husband are real tight, real close. And that's what I like to have, make friends in and out of the bedroom where we can talk about things and share stuff. But he, you know, we got a lot of footage together, me and her, Pornhub, and he'll edit stuff or post something. He'll be like, hey, Mars, did you see the new video I just put on my Pornhub? And I'm like, no, man, I don't go back and look at it. He's like, oh, well, if you want to, it's up. You can go back and look at it. And I'm like, all right, I might check it out, but I really don't. But
I got to go back and watch stuff.
Yeah, see, she liked it. She's a freak. She was free. Look at her right now. She's a freak. Got the titties out.
I had no idea. So part of your brand, Mars, is shooting interracial. You know, that's in your headlines on social media. First of all, what made you decide to do that?
So I knew this was gonna come up. The Caucasian women have been a thing for me since elementary school. My first, I guess, quote unquote girlfriend I had in the sixth grade was a white chick. And growing up, I'm from the country. It's just whites and blacks. And the only other time that I saw anybody outside of those races was during the summertime in the tobacco fields where we had the Mexicans coming to pull tobacco. That's all I knew. And so, and my friends, you know, they weren't preaching race and stuff like that in my household. So when I first started, you know, quote unquote, seeing her or having a little girlfriend in sixth grade, I was scared to come home and like tell my parents like I'm got a white girlfriend and stuff like that and whatever. But that's what I've always been attracted to. Did I date sisters back in the day? Yeah, I dated sisters all through high school and in my early time frame, right out of high school in the Marine Corps, like in the early 90s. But I just prefer, my preference is just the Caucasian women. My first wife is Puerto Rican. I met her in Philly when I was stationed up there. And then my last three have been white. And so that's just my personal preference, you know? So.
Interesting. Do you ever catch a flack from black viewers or catch, you know, shit from them saying, oh, how come you don't shoot with, you know, black female talent? Or do you shoot with black female talent as well?
So funny story, it was at Exotica. I had a friend, one of my best friends with me, he showed up with me at Exotica last October. And so I got my business cards, I'm promoting on my table and hand out stuff like that. And the sisters were coming over and, you know, they look at it and, you know, oh, hey, how you doing? And they would read my card and see the interracial stuff. I was like, oh, so you want to shoot interracial? I'm like, yeah, pretty much. And my boy was behind me and he's whispering on my ear. He was like, you know, your card about to be thrown on the ground, right? And I'm like, you know, it is what it is. I know somebody, one of the producers, used to be a company when I started back in 2020, shot with a company, Lewd Lips, out of Florida, female company. I think they've disbanded now, but Carrie is her name. She does a lot of photography now. But she even told me, she's like, you know, you're going to put yourself in the corner by only doing this one group of females or whatnot. But like I tell everybody, I'm 48, almost 50. I've done what I wanted to do early on in my career, basically, you know, running out here, dicking everything, fucking everything that moved. And now, you know, I got somebody at home here at the house and, you know, that I got sex. It ain't like I'm fiending for nothing. So whatever I choose to do is what I choose to do. You're not going to make me do something outside of my comfort zone. So that's just been my thing for years and it really ain't changing. So that's where I'm at. You know, I'm cool with that.
Dope. Okay. Now, being in the South, you touched on this briefly, but nobody ever, you know, even on a personal tip, nobody ever gave you flack like, oh, he only messes with white girls, or, you know, did you ever get looked down upon for your preference?
No, not really. Not really. It's still racism here. I ain't gonna, you know, in the South.
As there is worldwide, nationwide.
Yeah. But some of these areas is real prevalent. You get them looks, you know, you might have somebody say something, but I hadn't really had anything, as far as nobody saying something or any backlash, with it do with regards to that here since I've been here. So.
Gotcha. Well, yeah. I do want to shift gears to talk a little bit more about what's behind you, the sneaker collection. Mm-hmm. So repeat to me one more time, how many pairs of kicks do you own? And what are some of your most prized possessions when it comes to this?
So currently I probably say about, and I got them over, and you know, it's all It's all through here, man. It's the old garage, but
oh my god,
yeah, it's a lifestyle. I say it's a lifestyle, but probably about 200 currently. And what I do, like yesterday, I was out selling some. They all my own personal collection, pretty much, and I might wear them once or twice. And depending on, you know, like say for the Kobe's, of course, they come out, they're gonna be high value jumping out. Any of the Jordans, stuff like that. And I think we talked before we went live about the new big red boots, the mischief boots, any of that type stuff. I might get and hold on and see what the value is gonna be for a year or so and see what kind of flip I can get. But for the most part, this behind me is just, that's my number one priority before anything else. It's I just enjoy collecting sneakers. It's been like that since the early age in fourth grade when I got my first pair of Jordans. Single kid, back to my mom, my dad growing up, they were like, look, we ain't got no $100 to be going out here buying you no sneakers. If you want to get them, you're going to have to get out here in these tobacco fields and go work for them. And that's been my hustle. I'm a hustler. And, you know, any of my extra money, spending money is usually going to polo or sneakers or something like that. So. That's my enjoyment right there, bro.
Very dope. And it's so authentically Southern when you say you want some extra money, you got to get out here in the tobacco fields.
Exactly, bro. Exactly.
Very dope. That was my first job too, Mars. Huh? Planting tobacco, stripping tobacco.
Look at you. Look at you.
Yeah.
All right. Okay.
Wow. I'm getting my Southern California self is getting such a good cultural exchange, you know. My first job was at a summer camp. Yeah, old elementary school. Yeah.
Come on out for one summer around July, August time frame and get in the bike fields. We'll break you in.
Okay, for sure. That would kind of make some funny content, I think.
Hell yeah.
Got Palm out there sweating, fucking picking stuff up.
Out there
in tobacco fields, my Cali ass goes, where the weed at?
Not here.
You can get that on your break. You get that on your break. Okay. With your Pepsi and a pack of Nabs on your 30-minute break.
Okay, dope. Okay. All right. Well, now, with the sneaker collection, Mars, I got to ask you, sneaker culture and hip-hop culture go hand in hand, man. Who is in Mars' top five, dead or alive, as far as the music?
This is going to be funny to you, because let me reverse it before I answer. Who are yours now? Who's your
okay. top five? Currently or of all time?
All time.
Okay, all time. You know, I'm an underground head. You know, I've been running a music publication for 8 years now. So, you know, I'm always Mr. Hipster Underground. So, Tyler, the Creator is number one.
Okay.
Slug from Atmosphere. I don't know if you're familiar with that group.
Okay.
Very dope underground hip hop group out of Minneapolis. The third spot is Interchangeable, but we can go with... Lately, I've been thinking about this a lot. Third spot is a brother named Jay Worthy out of Vancouver, Canada / Compton, California, Bompton. Fourth belongs to Kid Cudi.
Okay.
And fifth was occupied by Kanye West, but I'll try to separate the art from the artist and keep Kanye there. But if on the days that I can, I'll yield the fifth to Suicide Boys.
All right. Gotcha. Okay. I like that. So me... Classic 90s old school hip hop.
There you go. I'm all golden
about
era.
That, yeah, I'm all about that lyrical value. Put you in the booth with Big Tigger and let you spit some fire. That's what I'm all about.
Ooh, so love that era. Rap City, the Basement.
Oh Big my Tigger. God, man. That's and I'm gonna tell you, anytime I'm on my Facebooks or posts, it's all old school shit. And it's just gonna be off the wall. It's gonna be like somebody you usually probably think about. People say Biggie and Pac and Jay-Z and all that. I got some. Here we go. Papoose. Okay. Black Thought.
Nice, yeah.
Wu-Tang.
Cool.
Got to go with Nas because he's my Virgo brother. He's September the 14th. I'm September the 17th. That's my
one of the first rap concerts I ever went to was Nas.
Followed round about by a group, Wu-Tang. You can't beat that.
Say Wu-Tang again.
Yeah, Wu-Tang. There you go. Did I say I gave him already?
Yeah. Wu-Tang was Wu-Tang was already on there.
All right. Well, Black Thought, Wu-Tang, Papoose, Nas, and I give Biggie round it out.
Okay. Yeah. For sure. Being a Carolinian, let me ask you this: are you familiar with Little Brother?
Yeah.
So you mess with that with Fonte and Big Pooh?
Yes. I was listening to, because you know, old boy from De La Soul just passed away.
Yeah, yeah. Rest in peace.
So they were doing, yeah, they were doing some Camp Low and some collabs that De La Soul had throughout. But I think Lil Brother was sort of like in the mix the other night when they was doing tribute. So, yeah, familiar with them.
Cold. To your point, 90s hip-hop, I will agree, stylistically is the best era. You know, I think followed by maybe early 2000s back rap era. And then I was tweeting from my OG account today that like that blog rap era from 09 to like maybe 2012 was phenomenal.
You know, right.
Big effect on me. Then up to like, you know, that first good wave of SoundCloud rap. And then all the new shit that came out of LA. But yeah, 90s is probably the most goated and golden out of all of that.
If you want to nod your head, put them 90s on, and your head will be nodding the whole night, man. Get some good drink, some edibles, and you good. You
stylistic. Good, I don't really do. I don't do edibles these days. They got to be like a really, really small dose, because the Cali weed is just too strong, man.
You're right. Yeah, I ain't gonna lie. You're right. You're right.
Straight up. Didn't you? You were telling me you were stationed in SoCal at one point, right?
Yeah, Seal Beach, out there near Long Beach.
Okay.
02 to 05 time frame, and it was. Good times, good vibes. Definitely, again, part of my that would have been my second divorce, because the California women, it was just a whole different. They would keep you out all night long and hear me just foolish out there in Cali. So that was part of my divorce process out in Cali. Being
ouch. Okay. Yeah. Well, West Coast to the South, man. Can you compare and contrast? You know, between the cultures, the foods, the women, like. Your experience in both. I mean, obviously you're back home, but you know, tell me, you know, you've lived in multiple places. Tell me, what are the vibe changes like coast to coast?
Food different, you know, food over here, you know, we got the spices and the seasoning, that down home Southern cooking, the fat back meat, the whole diabetic type food, you know what I'm saying, over here.
Talk to me.
Compared to the West, and used to be stationed up near Seattle and Everett. You know, we got the sweet tea, and you go anywhere else, they like, sweet tea? We don't do that sweet tea. We give you some kind of other kind of tea, man. But definitely the food is different. You say as far as the culture, it's more laid back, you know, in these Southern states per se, instead of the whole hustle and bustle out in some of these other big cities, which is cool. Me personally, I want to... You know, we out here in South Carolina right now, but the final resting place, my retirement, when it's all said and done, I'm retired now, but I'm saying the final lay my head at last house being built is going to be in Vegas. You know, I like that area, the hot weather. I'm a gambler. They don't tax military retirement, so that's another plus. And, you know, so we reason why we hadn't moved yet is, you know, we both both our mothers are still alive, my wife's mother, my mother. So we don't want to be that far out west in case anything happens to either one of them back here in the Carolinas. So, but yeah, that's definitely coming in the near future.
So
I'm going to come see y'all before you move.
Yeah. You know, you're welcome. You know, you're welcome. You can come see us now.
I know. I'm going to. About 2 months.
Okay.
Dope. Okay. So speaking of family, how did your peoples react to you getting into the adult entertainment business?
So really, it's nobody but me, my mother, mm-hmm. and I have a daughter who just turned 26 last month. Our relationship has been rocky for the past couple of years. So, you know, it is what it is on that aspect. My mother had this question wrote down too. My mother is in the country. Like I say, we're in the country to the point where she don't have no internet down there. She can't see nothing. She's 77. So the only way she's gonna know about me doing some, and it wouldn't surprise her if she found out. She was just down here for Christmas and if something happened in the house. I did something or said something to my wife, and my mom was like, well, don't nothing surprise me about my son. I wouldn't put nothing past my son. So I you know, if she was to find out or hear about it, it is what it is. So that's really all I'm concerned about. If my wife supports me, my mother-in-law knows about what I do. She supports me, and I live by the three F's personally. And those are, if you ain't feed me, fucking me, and support me,
financing me,
yeah, I could give a fuck about your opinion. I'm a grown ass man. I've served this country and I'm living life now. And I live by two mottos: YOLO, you only live once, and tomorrow ain't promised. So I'm just out here living each day like it's my last. So that's why, amen. That's what I live. Yeah.
That's a beautiful thing. Yes, well, sir. Mars, I want to get into some segments here. Let's go down in the DM. What is the craziest, funniest, most out-of-pocket, ridiculous DM or email you have ever received?
Oh, Jesus, man. I have to say, man, you get these crazies. And I just got one yesterday. And it might have been a little different, but in general, you get these DMs, the hubbies. Hey, I want you to fuck my wife.
Yeah. And the cucks really do hit the male talent like hard, is what I'm starting to really see when I'm interviewing more and more guys.
Yeah. And it's like, okay, and of course it's a fake, you know, account or whatever. It's like, okay, what does she look like? You got a picture. And then they'll send you back a body shot, but the head's cut off. And I'm like, that ain't telling me. I need to see what she looks like or whatever. Yeah. I mean, that's not doing enough for me. And then second of all, do you even know where I'm located at? Or you even, and then, you know, like, oh, we in Russia or, you know, somewhere. And like, you know, stop wasting my time or whatever. But it's stuff like that's the nonsense that I get about, you know, doing that or... I think that's probably the craziest. It's probably weekly that I get something like that in my DM about helping some guy out and doing something. So, yeah.
Fascinating. Okay. Let me ask you this, Mars. Ever too much? Has it ever been too much in a scene? Like, cut the camera. It's not pleasurable. You can't hold yourself together. Has it ever been too much?
Elaborate on that. What do you mean too much? Too much sexual tension?
No, like physically unpleasurable, you can't handle it, or anything in a scene that's been so uncomfortable, be it the physical or the tension in the room, the vibes wrong, you know, things that go wrong on set.
No, not really. I mean, you do have it where you got to cut the camera. You know, from a male talent perspective, you know, if the tool ain't working, you know, you got to cut, take a break and rework things on that aspect. But as far as like any intention, I think O’Mya probably can vouch, you really don't try to put yourself out there. I personally try to research who I'm going to be working with beforehand. I don't want to just show up and hadn't discussed something with a talent, female talent beforehand. Like I'm talking a day or two or weeks prior to, like you said, we talked 2 months before we even got together. Hey, what do we want to do? What are you looking for? And just laying it all out. So by the time we do get together, things are comfortable. We, you know, we talking, we getting down to business, we doing our work, and then, you know, we got time to play and shoot the shit afterwards. But I don't try to put myself in a situation where it's going to be tension or just the unknown, I'd say, beforehand. So it's been, I've had nothing but great shoots thus far.
There you go. Yeah, good communication has become such a mantra of Thiccness Protection Program, you know, so I like when all the guests, you know, say that it all kind of boils down to that.
Exactly.
Okay. You shoot predominantly with MILFs, and I love that because, you know, I'm a MILF connoisseur myself. You know, with the women aging like fine wine, tell me, what was your decision that made you want to predominantly shoot with women who are a little older?
So, another thing that I got, you know, with doing this and calling my own shots is I said that, you know, I don't age limits. I don't want to shoot necessarily with somebody my daughter's age, you know, I don't.
No one in her 20s, except for this chick.
So,
except on mine. That's
been one of the things. And then the seasoned women, you know, and they say in their 40s, they don't know. Another level. And, you know, I'm 40 and like, I like to call myself, you know, I'm at the age where I can fuck the mamas and the daughters, you know, I'm in between and you know, I'm cool with those 40-year-olds because they know what they want. A lot of them are either married or divorced and they just, you know, doing their own thing there and ready to live life. Some of them have been in previous marriages where they couldn't do what they want to do and now they out doing what they want to do. So I just prefer the whole, probably I say, you know, between the 40 and 60 is my cutoff. I don't go past 60, try not to. But those are my ideal ranges when it comes to, you know, shooting the more mature women. And then also, I was asked this about the other day, I like the females, you know, it's some, again, like back to Sarah J, it's some females that I got on my bucket list, but I like, just like O’Mya being my first, being her first male collaborator, I like the females that haven't really been showcased yet and been out there yet and got those big numbers. I like being the first guy, hey, who was your first guy? Or Mars Blac or whatever, or bringing them to the forefront. Like, hey, you know, you want to shoot? Oh, I ain't shot with a guy yet. Yo, you can be my first. I like doing those. So that's what I get out of it.
Solid. Okay. Kind of breaking in somebody new.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
What did you say?
I said definitely.
Yeah.
Like, literally breaking in somebody new.
O’Mya, we'll start with you on this one. Do you have any creators that you're planning to work in the near future, or anybody who you want to work with coming up?
In the near future, I'll be shooting with company wise. I don't know who the male talent will be, but I'll be shooting with a Nasty Media Group in New York next weekend. So that should be pretty nasty.
I see. Yeah. When I just had Magic Montana and Rizzy on, Rizzy was gearing up to shoot with them.
Yeah, that's been scheduled for a second. Creator wise, I don't have any collabs planned until like June, whenever I host the content house. Like I've got my video stockpiled, so I'm not really focused on collabs right now. So
you're not collabing with me in Exotica?
You know what? You're right. You're the only one.
Okay.
You're gonna hurt some feelings, but you're right.
Okay.
Right. Love to see it. Okay, Mars. Let's go in on skin deep, man. You are a tatted up brother. I see the sneakerhead literally on your face. So, you know, that's the, I want to call it the religion, but that's like, you know, says a lot about who you are right there.
Yeah.
What I was kind of fascinated on is the one on your chest with the dog. Like, what? Tell me about what that one's all about.
Oh, that was my old Rottweiler, and his name was Polo. Like I said, everything is Ralph Lauren or Polo related. So that was my old Rottweiler that I had. And so most of my tattoos got some kind of meaning behind them.
Yeah.
I think the dog was actually a cover up of a female's name. So it was already tattooed out, but I had the rot covered up. But that's the meaning behind the dog. It was my old Rottweiler's name's Polo. But pretty much any tattoo that I got has been during my time in the military, you know, deployed somewhere, stationed somewhere. I always like to try to get some kind of tattoo in whatever state or whatever country I was in, and, you know, just have something in remembrance of that.
Right on. What's the one above your eyebrow say?
So yeah, that's why you brought it up. So I'm a homeboy. It was I'm a spur of the moment type dude. I want what I want when I want it. So originally, you know, with the whole sneakerhead thing, I got a guy that does them, and I went over. He does them in his crib, and I went over. And I sort of had an idea of how I wanted the sneakerhead to be on my you know, sneakerhead. It goes on my head. Everybody can see it and be like, "Yeah, you sneakerhead." But of course, when you get tattoos, you know how your skin changes and everything like that. It's sort of jumbled up to where you really can't, if you don't see it, you really can't tell what the wording says because it sort of done got jumbled up together. So I'm like, well, this really didn't work out how I wanted it. So I was in Vegas last year, and you know, they got a sneaker spot, Urban. Can't think of names. I'm losing train of thought now. But they have a tattoo spot inside the sneaker store in Vegas.
Dope.
And yeah, dope. And their tattoo artists are top notch. And you got to make appointments. And I mean, it's exclusive. So I was like, you know, if anybody can do a sneaker tattoo, let me hit up these guys. And that way, when somebody does see it, they can sort of relate. All right, we must sneak ahead and got a sneaker. And so that's where that came from. I do plan on getting on the other side, like a Jordan 3. I have like the Jordan 3s, 5s, and 1s are my top Jordans. But hopefully when I go back to Vegas sometime this year or whatever, I'll get the Jordan 3 on this side, and then I'll be done with my face stuff. So
solid. Yeah. Okay. Now, I can't really read it from here, but what does the one on above the eyebrow read?
Sneakerhead.
Yeah. Okay. Got you. Okay.
Yeah.
We're going to get into a couple Instagram questions. O’Mya, to put you on the spot, someone has asked, does O’Mya do fan meet and greets?
Oh my God. Why would you ask me that?
It's not me asking.
with security, will Mars be present?
I'm gonna say it really depends. Like, I'm super picky about it. Yeah, like, I do, like, a lot of, like, fetish meats. Foot worship, I'll do that. That's fine. Other things, it really depends on the person. Like, I do not care to tell somebody, no, I'm not dealing with you. If you're disrespectful, I'm not dealing with you. If you can't screen with me, I'm not dealing with you. I do a lot of just, like, regular, like, companion dates. Like, you see me going to the opera house. That's what I'm doing. I'm being paid to go hang out with somebody.
Gotcha.
I'm fine with that.
With companion dates, are you ever you stole the words out of my mouth. Are you ever concerned for your safety?
I would say my safety's first. That's why you have to screen. Like, you have to screen with me. I'm not going to do that. I'm not a dumb woman. I'm going to say that. And that's why I'm very picky with who I see. So that's my answer to that.
Understood. Okay. Now, another question, I believe, from the same viewer was, what are your thoughts on MFM threesomes? Open-ended to whoever's ready to take that one.
I'm not ready for that. On my end, like me personally,
That's two dudes and a girl, right?
Yeah. I'm not ready for that. Like, I'm not, like, that's not my speaking. I prefer, like, two females and a dude are just... Or hell, four females and a dude. I don't know. I prefer females over males anyway. So two males isn't really what I want to do yet. So not for me.
I've done it. I don't, not on camera, but in my personal life, you know, I done it all in my personal life. So me personally, I'm cool with the male, female, male. I don't like the whole... And my convention is, I don't like the whole group orgy type stuff, but I'm cool with the male, female, male, or the female, female, male. I'm cool with all that stuff.
Got it. Okay. You're more open to it, but not necessarily to shoot as it. Like, you're experienced with it, but you're not into, like, creating it for your own brand.
Right. Yeah, you can say that. Just in my personal endeavors. Yeah, I mean, I'm all about it. All the time, but not necessarily.
Do you shoot the gangbang scenes, Mars? Do you shoot gangbang scenes?
Hey, personal?
Do you shoot gangbang?
Personal.
Personal.
Yeah.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah. So me, and just to jump in, and I was looking at you, I looked at some of your videos. The J. Crew video was outstanding, brother.
Thank you, homie.
My ultimate goal in this is not to be, as we get older, you know, you can't be in front of the camera all the time. My ultimate goal is to be behind the camera, you know, and I'm sort of touch on it a little bit and hashtag it sometimes with the whole editing and everything I do myself is the whole Mars B Productions. I want to eventually be behind the camera and shooting my own personal production company. And that's where I want to be at and have male and female talents underneath me, under my brand and doing my thing that way. So hopefully in the next year or two, I can make moves towards that. That's where I eventually want to be.
Right. Actually, that was kind of what I was thinking of asking you. Like, could you see yourself, you know, hiring male talents and hiring female talents? Yeah. Like, they just do the scene and you just produce it.
Exactly. That's where I want to be at. Yeah. I had a guy actually reach out to me. He's a cop in New York and, you know, low key. He just told me that's all he is. But he was like, well, I know you do interracial. And I'm like, it really don't matter when it comes to, you know, whoever's underneath me. I don't black, white, whatever. I'm just there to shoot. Edit the footage and put it out there. So you don't have to be an interracial content creator or whatever. I'm just there to get you out there and market the footage that we're doing. So.
Excellent. Okay. Now, just before we get up on out of here, guys, I want to leave you both with this one. What is the biggest misconception of a porn star, XXX content creator?
Go ahead, Amaya. You want it first?
I would say that, like, we just, like, we're willing to have sex with anybody, do anything. Like, that's not it. I care about, like, people are like, oh, you want to do a collab, and then they don't care about the lighting, they don't care about the camera angles, they don't care about none of that. I care about all of that, the full production. I care about all of that. And a lot of people think that it's just
just fucking, like, you just go fuck, and that's what it is. No, that's not for me anyway.
Yep.
Gotcha. Yeah, I'm learning more and more every time I interview male talent that it's like, they're, you know, every man wants to fuck bad bitches, but it's that, but to be a performer and to be a videographer and a producer is just like there's way more into it than what people see, you know, when they're jerking off.
We can fuck. We're gonna fuck good, but it's gonna look good too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I'm like, oh my, piggyback off her. It's got to be, you know, I'm all about, even when, so with me, you might see, I'm big on doing the pictures and stuff like that. Everything we do is not necessarily going to be on video. I like doing the whole picture concepts and planning ahead. You know, like I got stuff we shot 2 months back for Valentine's Day, to post Valentine's. I got stuff just ready to go for St. Patrick's Day, stuff like that. But when we're doing that, wherever we at, and I'm the type that usually, I like Airbnbs. Airbnb or some kind of, and I'm a jokester, you might see, no outside interest hotels, mate. We ain't shooting at the Red Roof. We ain't shooting at the Motel 6. We getting some high quality hotels, or we get a nice Airbnb, and it's going to be laid out like some quality content. And, you know, you get these, I get hit up all the time by these guys, you know, in the DMs. Hey, can you get me in? I don't have the answers to this, you know, and I had a situation and a few months back, guy hit me up, talked a real good game. We actually talked for about 40 minutes. He was good game. And then next thing I know, one of the female talents I work with hits me up and was like, hey, do you know this guy? And I'm like, well, I just talked to him like, you know, 40 minutes or whatever. And he told me such and such. And then he starts coming at her, you know, like with the whole dick pictures and just disrespect and everything. And I'm like, this is it. I'm not wasting my time to give nobody no advice and none of this stuff. You got to get in here and get it on your own. So that's the whole biggest misconception these guys don't understand is females get these dick pictures 24/7. You got to be able to come at them with some kind of logical conversation. And that's what kills me about it. If you're going to be a collaborator, you already know what the purpose is. You're going to eventually end up having sex on camera. So you don't need to be in these chicks' DMs and inboxes talking about sex and this and that. And what you're going to do, you need to be talking about collabs, what you want to do, how you want to do it, this and that. And that right there should show a male or female how they come in. If they're talking all that stuff, block, delete, whatever. Everybody got time for that.
So guys should know it's not about flirting or macking. It's about business.
Exactly.
It's what you bring to the table.
Yeah.
What you bring to the table.
So, Mars, do you edit all your own videos as well?
Everything, brother.
All in house. I love that.
Yeah. Shout out to I had to put it out and today is his birthday, Petit Professor. Her husband goes by The Remedy, and I picked up skills from him. I picked up skills from Becky Taylor's husband. So of course, when you're working with people and they've been doing it a while, or they got these particular skills, they give you some insights on how to edit and do some other things. So both of them guys have helped me a lot with bringing my stuff up.
Solid. Okay. Yeah. Cause I've realized, you know, the editing process and the Photoshop process is such a must of this business. So that's also, you know, me being an internet hustler, that's also, you know, something that I've admired about the XXX world. Last thing I wanted to know, a frequent collaborator of yours, Mars, is Davina Rains. I definitely want to get her down with the thickness. So I want to know, what's it like working with her?
Lovely, man. That's my girl. We talk at least once a week. We talked last night, actually, and we actually got an Airbnb together in Chicago at Exotica. But that's my homie right there. Great female, down to earth, and she's about her business too. When you hit her up, you better come correct. Don't come in with no bullshit. But yeah, we definitely, people like seeing us together, straight, natural pog ass, and I love it. So you'll definitely be seeing a lot more. We got some stuff that's in the works dropping soon. And I can definitely put a word in and get her on here with you, man.
Very dope. Yeah, I'll look forward to a future episode with her. And then, hey, you are invited back, my man.
Most definitely. I'll be in O’Mya spot. Yeah, I do that. I'm cool with that.
For sure. Okay.
And I appreciate you taking the time, bro. I like the Rockets. I told my man, y'all, when y'all see this, hey, can you do a little something with the Rockets? And he done came through with the Rockets for me and everything, you know? So I appreciate the love on that, bro.
Last minute's the best minute, man. I wish I could do like a little more in-house made, you know, palm made with love Rocket graphic. But, you know, hey, I hope you're okay with these stickers. You feel me? Yeah. The emojis.
Love it. Love it.
Good looking. All right. Well, to both of you, thank you so much for getting down with the thickness. O’Mya, it's great to see you. Thank you for coming back. Why don't you both throw out your socials and let them know where they can follow you and then check out all your content.
Ladies first.
My Twitter is O_MYA_BBW. O’Mya BBW. And all my links are on my Twitter. So that's your best place to go.
Me, I got Linktree pretty much on all my stuff, but it takes you wherever. But pretty much, I think everything besides IG, because IG won't let me have the three X's for some reason, but I'm Mars, M-A-R-S, like the planet, .black, B-L-A-C, not with the K, XX on IG, and then pretty much on everything else is Mars Blac XXX. But again, if you find me on IG or Twitter, you can hit my Linktree, you can find me anywhere pretty much, so.
Well, there you have it. Very dope. Okay. Well, everybody, thank you for listening. This has been another episode of Thiccness Protection Program. If you're watching on YouTube, please like the video, subscribe to the channel, and turn on your notification bell. If you are listening on Spotify, make sure you are following the podcast and make sure you please leave us a rating. The Thiccness Protection Program on Instagram. I made it a lot easier than whatever it was before. And then I'm at Thiccness Pro on Twitter. And yeah, that's it. Thank you both for getting down with the thickness.
I'll let you,
y'all. Peace.
We want bigger.